Released by Square in 1993 on the Super Nintendo, Secret of Mana would be a sequel to the first game released under the name Final Fantasy Adventure. Directed by series creator Koichi Ishii and written by Hiromichi Tanaka, the game would streamline conventions and concepts to make a distinct franchise going forward. For story, the game features three young warriors, a swordsman named Randy, a strong-willed girl named Prim, and a powerful sprite named Popoy. For gameplay, the game features real-time combat with enemies on the field, as the other two characters not controlled by the player may either be controlled by AI or up to two other players. Each character could master multiple weapons, allied AI behaviors could be set, and an early form of a radial menu would provide quick individual menu access. Originally designed to be a launch title for the Super Nintendo CD peripheral, when the hardware project was cancelled, the original vision for the game was stripped down to fit on a traditional cartridge, resulting in harsh cuts to the narrative and a rushed English translation job. The story only gets larger from here, so let's cut it down to size with a recapitation. As the game begins, we learn Mana has led to the rise of civilizations, culminating in the creation of a superweapon, the Mana Fortress. However, this action angered the gods who sent beasts to destroy the fortress. The ensuing war would almost spell the end of the world's mana were it not for a hero with the Mana Sword destroying the fortress in time. Though only a few civilizations would survive, history would seem poised to repeat itself. We now see a boy named Randy following some village boys near a waterfall, and despite it being a forbidden spot by their village elder, the rumor of treasure lures them onward. Unfortunately, Randy slips and falls down from a great height, panicking the boys and causing them to return to the village. Randy survives the fall, but soon hears a voice call out to him, passing by a sword and a stone, glinting in the water. As he pulls the sword from the stone, a blinding light bursts out, and Randy sees the ghost of a fallen warrior who says he asked the sword of something. But before Randy can learn more, the ghost disappears in another flash of light. Returning to his home in POTUS Village, Randy is called on by the village elder, who is glad to see he is safe, but shocked to see he pulled the Mana Sword. Unsure how Randy pulled it out, legend has it the village will be finished if removed. One of the boys blames Randy for the monsters attacking the village and punches out at him, when the ground beneath them rumbles and a hole opens up, swallowing them both. Mystical blade in hand, Randy edges out a victory against the monstrous mantis, and they are pulled up by a knight who recognizes the Mana Sword immediately. Story goes it will be pulled out by a knight in times of trouble, and is also unsure how Randy drew the blade, wondering if there is something wrong with the sword itself. He sees it needs to be re-energized, and only the one who drew it can do so. The knight directs them to seek Sage Luca in the Water Palace for more information, as she has been protecting the land for over 200 years. Unfortunately, the other villagers blame Randy for the appearance of the monsters, and despite being the one to take in and raise Randy, the elder has no choice but to cast him out to appease the village. Before he goes, he tells Randy his mother left him here as a baby and just disappeared, hoping he'll find her someday. Traveling to the Water Palace, he crosses paths with some soldiers led by Major Diluc from the city of Pandora, here to fight Eleni, a dangerous witch in the Haunted Forest. Arriving at the temple, he sees the 200-year-old sage Luca has the appearance of a young girl, and is aware Randy has claimed a sword, mentioning the reason is the current weakness of Mana's power. She confirms the balance of Mana shifted enough to revive monsters, some of which are specifically seeking to steal the power of the Mana Sword. Defeating the monsters will help restore the power of the sword, kept in orbs, though they need to find someone to reforge the sword to release its stored power. Next, she warns the knight named Gemma of the Empire seeking to claim the Mana Fortress, which can destroy the world by means of unlocking the seals on the world's mana seeds. She then asks him to seek the King of Pandora and warn him to keep up his guard. Gemma agrees and tells Randy to go to Gaia's Navel to find the dwarves there and find someone to reforge his blade. Luca explains ancients used the Mana Fortress in their final battle and were saved by the Mana Sword, though it has used the last of its power to call out to Randy. Having him hold the sword up to the siege, he shows him how to seal a mana seed with the Mana Sword, so its power will only be sent to Randy in the sword. She gives him a spear and urges him to find the other seven palaces around the world. However, as he sets out for Gaia's Navel beyond Pandora, he is ambushed and caught by goblins who begin stewing him in a pot. Fortunately, a girl spots him and saves him from being cooked alive with a mighty throw. Randy thanks her for saving his life, but she admits she thought he was someone else at first and leaves without giving him her name. Randy makes it safely to Pandora, where he learns the Empire attacked Pandora 15 years ago, and runs into the girl again. In exchange for saving Randy's life, she asks his help in saving the man she loves, Diluc, but Randy is more focused on finding the underground palace. She introduces herself as Prim and joins along, though they meet with Gemma and the king first, who share the witch Eleni is draining everyone's energy. As a knight of Tasnica, he says he'll handle her on behalf of his Pandora allies, and reminds Randy to head to Gaia's Navel. All the same, Randy tries to help Prim rescue Diluc, but their path through the Haunted Woods is blocked and they would need an axe to get past. Prim suggests skinning one from the dwarves in Gaia's Navel and agrees to go there with Randy next. Discovering the village of dwarves, they hear of a sprite child performing magic and see it's indeed working tricks to scam money from strangers. Caught in the act, the elder dwarf and sprite give back the money, but as the sprite really did get swept here by a flood from the sprite forest. Finding the smithy Watts, he easily reforges the mana sword, noting his hammer glowing strangely as new energy fills it and recognizing the power of the mystical blade. Waiting as he makes them an axe, they step outside and see another monster is attacking the village and help the sprite child defeat it, who turns out to have lost his memories. The elder notes the monster broke out of a nearby sealed palace and figures there must be a way into it now, and wonders if the sprite's memory may return if they receive some of the mana seed's power. Going by the name Popoy, the sprite joins the group, but they learn the once good witch Eleni surrounded the way to the underground palace with lava, and so, axe in hand, they leave to deal with the witch first. Chopping their way forward, they come across Eleni's hidden castle and catch up to dialogue confronting the witch herself before being warped away. She mentions he was too strong for her magic and sent him away to Thanatos, the head of a secret organization that intends to overthrow the kingdom, who is already poised to strike from nearby ruins. Defeating her spiky pet, she loses her magic power and reverts to her normal form, confessing that with mana dying across the land, she resorted to using herbs from Thanatos. She reveals where Thanatos and Diluc are, and Prim is just glad to know he is alive. Suddenly, Luca calls out to Randy, calling him back and tells him about Undine, the water elemental whose protective seal has suddenly failed and so may be in trouble. Saving the spirit, the elemental gives Prim and Popoy the ability to use a variety of magic and assures Randy their powers will both support the growing might of the Mana Sword. With Undine's magic, they freeze the lava blocking the way to the underground palace, wherein they gain the aid of the elemental spirit gnome. After approaching the Mana Seed, Popoy recovers his memories and he remembers his home in the Upperland Forest and asks to be taken there. Taking a cannon back to Pandora, they investigate Thanatos' ruins where Prim sees her friend Fana under a strange spell. She shoves away Prim and enters the ruins, and when the group follows her in, they encounter the scourged Pandora. Thanatos says he needs life energy to create a more peaceful world by means of the Mana Fortress, revealing Diluc under his influence as well, noting there's a special power within him. As the group overcomes his trapped room, Thanatos recognizes the Mana Sword and chooses to release Pandora of his curse, but specifically keeps both Fana and Diluc. Seeing Gemma as among those freed, the knight finds it awfully suspicious Thanatos is extracting life energy from the people when the Empire only needs the power from the seeds. Speaking up, Luca alerts them to the fact the Mana Seed of Water was just stolen and senses it's below even Gaia's navel and does not believe the Empire is behind this. Following the lead, they find the Water Seed aboard a vessel of a Scorpion army who is more of a meddling gang. Wanting to use the Mana Seed for the super deluxe robot Kilroy, their plan backfires when they find it cannot handle the overwhelming power. Their robot destroyed, the Scorpion army quickly retreats, surrendering the Mana Seed. However, by the time they return to the Water Palace, they find it overrun by monsters and Luca herself captured by Gestar of the Empire. Taking the seed from the group, he breaks the seal and covers his escape with a monster. Afterwards, Gemma arrives to report they repel the Empire in Pandora, but must soon return to his home kingdom of Tatnica to aid in fighting the Empire on that front. Quickly restoring the seal, the group continues the power of the Mana Sword, and Luca advises they seek Sage Jock next in the lofty mountains. Taking a cannon to the upper land, they land among a group of Moogles who say their village has been taken over. Helping them out, they free the village, and Popoy suddenly regains his lost memories. Continuing to Popoy's village, they find it in shambles, and finding Popoy's grandfather, they learn the Empire undid the Windseal. He mentions that while sprites like them are made of mana, the humans are breaking seals and releasing monsters who in turn consume their source of life, mana. He lends them the aid of the wind elemental, Silphid, and tells them to head to Matango to seek out a white dragon there who will help them. In Matango, they speak with King Truffle, who knows where they can find a white dragon, but they only find one too small to be of much help, so the king offers to raise it for them in the meanwhile, naming it Flammy. He points them next to the Flame Palace in the desert of Kakara, and they travel by means of cannon, though end up in the middle of nowhere. By some fortune, they are saved by a secret Republic sand ship, though the commander in charge puts them to work with others, as all stranded are really just free labor for the ship. Randy meets Sergo the pirate, who helps him escape, as the Empire quickly discovers their location and boards. Fending off Gestar as the mech rider, the ship is ruined in the struggle and they find themselves just outside Kakara. They soon learn the fire spirit Salamando is missing, as is their water supply, and the fire palace is simply too hot to make much headway in. Making a detour to Ice Country, they land in Toto Village, inhabited by walrus folk, and later meet a lone red-nosed reindeer named Rudolph who is looking for his master. They encounter the hideout for the Scorpion army, wherein they free the captured Salamando being exploited for money. With its power, they venture into the Ice Palace and rescue Santa Claus from his forced transformation into a Frost Gigas due to the lack of belief from children. He elaborates that when mana fades, kids lose their hopes and dreams and wanting to restore the mana himself caught word that mana trees grow instantly. So he sought out a mana seed, wanting to make a Christmas tree of it, but the seed would change him into a monster. Returning the fire seed to the Flame Palace, Salamando's power fights fire with fire, helping them secure the mana seed within. However, this action does not return water to the village, and for that they will need a sea hare's tail. Traveling to the Empire, they keep a low profile through Southtown as they contact Mara, a Taznikan spy, and are led to others in the Resistance where they learn Diluc is draining people's energy in the ruins to the east. They find Fana nearby, and after Prim slaps some sense into her, they let the Resistance look after her. Further within the ruins, they find Diluc, though as Prim gets close to the man she loves, he seizes her and steals all of her life energy. Outraged, Randy slashes at Diluc, who is knocked back to his senses and immediately regrets his actions, telling them they can still save Prim from Thanatos nearby if they hurry. However, as Thanatos stands over Prim's body, it begins to glow with blinding light, and Prim revives thanks to Diluc giving her some of his life energy, and Thanatos pulls back for now. Checking back, the Resistance informs them the Emperor wants a truce, but as the party presents themselves, Emperor Vandal reveals the talks were just a trap to lure them out. He refers to Randy as the Mana Knight and confronts the group with his three generals, wherein Geshtar asks for another chance for redemption. The Emperor leaves with the two as Geshtar tries and fails to defeat the group. Choosing to burn the whole castle down with his defeat, the group seems trapped, but they suddenly hear the voice of King Truffle call out to them. Revealing the Wind Dragon Flammy has already matured to the point where it can fly, and has also imprinted itself on the group, wishing to help them. King Truffle directs them to the lofty mountains to find Sage Jock, and the group finds a temple that dates back to the Mana Fortress War. Within, a few relics called Videos retain glimpses of the old world and their timeless debates of media coverage, energy consumption, and game shows. Locating a sea hare's tail, they restore water back to Kakara and venture into the Palace of Darkness to recruit the elemental Shade. Heading to visit Sage Jock, his disciple Jek reports he is out at Gold Island. Finding the Empire's island is literally made of gold, though that comes with problems of its own. They rescue the elemental of light Lumina, who was being forced to produce gold. However, returning to Jek, it turns out Jock has gone to the Moon Palace now. As Karen helps ferry them across the starlit darkness, they find Luna within the Moon Palace. Once again, they miss Sage Jock, who has apparently left for the Republic of Taznica now. Arriving, they are greeted by Gemma, who warns them of an Imperial spy somewhere in the castle, and when meeting the king, they are accused immediately of being a spy. However, the charade is dropped quickly as the spy is rooted out and defeated, and the group gains the trust of the king. Gemma suspects the Empire's aggression is likely a sign of nearly having the Mana Fortress themselves. Returning to Sage Jock, who was actually in this time, he issues them a test of courage. Prevailing against shadow versions of themselves, they find Jock was actually an illusion by Jek, who says they will master the sword by combining courage, knowledge, and love. With their hearts strengthened, he points them to the Tree Palace atop the Mana Fortress itself, where the group finds the Emperor planning to raise the ancient continent by breaking all of the palace seals. Sheik steps forward to handle the group, revealing he was the Dark Stalker in the Republic earlier. He assumes a monstrous form, revealing they all signed an underworld contract giving them power over this world and are reviving the Mana Fortress in order to keep humans under their control. Though they defeat Sheik's for good, he still bought enough time for the Emperor to destroy the last seal as the tree spirit Dryad comes out telling them to leave before the continent rises. It explains Thanatos also sealed its magic, but the group still takes it along as they escape in time to see the continent of Mana rise up, revealing the Mana Fortress. Gemma arrives with knights to hold back the Emperor's underworld forces as the group ventures after the Emperor. Within, they encounter an intact subway train full of undead before running into the Scorpion army down here and send them blasting off again. Draining the way to the Grand Palace, they find Emperor Vandal dead on his feet in front of the Mana Seed. Beyond, they find Fauna, who admits to defeating the Emperor herself as part of a coup with Thanatos to rule the world with the Mana Fortress. Prim asks about Diluc, and Thanatos says he's perfectly fine, as he will soon become his new body. Defeating the demonic form of Fauna, they corner Thanatos, who uses ancient magic to create an undead cyborg Geshtar of his own. Defeating the creation, they see they are too late in stopping the activation of the Mana Fortress and escape in time to see it rise. Gemma says any minute now the Mana Beast will appear and crash into the fortress, ending the world. Not giving up hope, he then brings up Sage Jock's mention of a Pure Land at the world's end. Normally, it's hidden behind a magical barrier, but with the fortress absorbing the world's mana, the barrier is likely removed now. He adds the seeds that they have been benefiting from so far, just a small part of the mana tree. As such, if they find the tree itself, then they can instantly power up the mana sword. Finding the undiscovered country, they hear a voice beckoning, and defeating the Wardens of the Wood, they discover the mythical mana tree. They find themselves suddenly taken to the base of a tree, but only find a massive stump instead. Wondering what this means, the tree speaks to Randy, explaining the Mana Fortress is using up most of the world's mana. In addition, all of the beasts will be combined and transformed into one giant creature, and though only the Great Mana Beast can bring back mana, it has little control over its rage, and the world would be finished if it were to attack the Mana Fortress. The only way to avert disaster is to defeat the beast with the Mana Sword, usable only by the Tribe of Mana people. The Mana Tree reveals Randy's father was a legendary Knight Saren killed by the Empire 15 years ago in Podos. Randy then thinks the ghost he saw by the waterfall must have been his father, and the tree confirms this as it was once Saren's wife and Randy's mother, making them all members of the Mana Tribe. She explains the women of their tribe become the Mana Tree and thus protect the world, and the men take up the Mana Sword and in turn protect the tree. She then uses the last of her energy to summon the remaining power of the Mana Seeds and apologizes to Randy for not being much of a mother before falling silent. Storming the Mana Fortress, they discover valuable ancient research notes within as they chase down Thanatos. The Dark Mage announces he has long been searching for a human with the power to conquer the world, born in the shadow of darkness yet raised in the light of mana like Diluc. He moves to take Diluc's body as his new vessel, but Prim punches him away, shattering Thanatos' body. However, Diluc laughs as Thanatos has already seized him, but suddenly freezes as Diluc tries to resist his control. Briefly in control, Diluc states Thanatos is an ancient sorcerer who sold his heart to the underworld and is only a detached life force with no tangible body of his own. His life force sustains itself on hatred and destruction, and Diluc sacrifices himself to release the Lich's true form. Losing control, Thanatos lashes out, intent on seizing the bodies of the group now. However, for the sake of Diluc, Prim and the others destroy the Lich's monstrous form. With his defeat, the curse on Dryad lifts and Prim mourns Diluc, but it's not long before the fortress begins to come under attack from the Mana Beast. Popoi is visibly weakened as mana is almost gone, and the group sees the Mana Beast looks just like a flammy dragon. Randy suddenly feels conflicted about attacking a beast only trying to restore mana and destroying the life sources of creatures like sprites. Popoi then clarifies that even if he runs out of mana, he won't disappear per se, just leave this world as it is a separate one from theirs. He tells Randy it's more important he save this world, and as the wielder of the Mana Sword, it is a task only he can do. As the group prepares to face down the Mana Beast, Popoi explains he and Prim will cast Mana Magic into the Mana Sword, restoring its power long enough for Randy to strike down the Mana Beast. Bracing against the attacks against the fortress, the trio of heroes, Randy, Prim, and Popoi, strike down the sacred beast, destroying it to save the world. As the game ends, Randy and Prim find Popoi has already left this world, and they thank him and Diluc for their sacrifice. They also see the Mana Beast has turned into gentle snow that now covers a world without mana. Revisiting the allies they made along the way, Prim returns to her hometown and Randy finds Podos has forgiven him as well. Randy returns the Mana Sword to its resting place below the waterfall, and in the empty sprite village, Popoi looks upward at the moon from another world. Secret of Mana has enjoyed the success of selling over 2.6 million copies worldwide.